All right, so first of all, just to give you kind of a quick overview, just for those of you like insights and what all this means and cold branding, it really talks about loyalty and who are your customers that love you the most and why would they be passionate and talk about your brand. So over years of studying customer love, Dave and I have had a relationship of friendship of ideas based on building great brands. Now, some of the brands that I have worked for have been the likes of Coca-Cola and Turner Classic Movies, but then at the retail level, we were also helping independent retailers succeed and beat, Dave, the snot, right?
Beating the snot out of the big guys.
I've had a dual job, so I do like insights, but at the same time, I really enjoy the tactical efforts and like building business plans and ideas that really work at every level of the business. So a lot of what we're gonna go through today is going to be an entire overview of how you should market and advertise your business from the top down. In other words, from a strategic level, and then we're gonna funnel in to actual tactics that you can do and making sure that you understand how to use all these various tactics. And then finally, we'll give you a few tips that are gonna help you understand how to make your store a wow experience. Even if you're a smaller business, you're gonna learn some of the tricks that make the consumer go wow when they walk into your store. So I think that we have a pretty awesome perspective, and it's going to come from a very big picture, and it's going to narrow down all the way to very functional, tactical things that you have to do. So everybody would want to see their store, sort of like this image here, people shopping and buying, and the consumer's excited to be into your location. So how do we bring customers into our retail space, into our businesses, that are very excited to shop and tell their friends? So one of the things that you have to learn, even though branding has gone away a little bit because everyone thinks about promotions and I gotta promote, but while you're promoting, people are gonna remember those promotions, and what they remember from those promotions become your brand. A brand for a company is like a reputation for a person. So what type of person is your brand? What is it known for? Is your store boring? Is your store exciting? Is your store fun to come into? Is it something that people feel like they're at home? What is the emotion that your brand gives your customers? And then Jeff Bezos goes on to saying, you earn a reputation by trying to do hard things well. Is it easy to be cordial to every customer? Is it easy?
Anyone want to answer that? Every customer? Is it easy to be cordial to every customer?
Is it easy to find what your customers love? No. But doing that is a hard thing that will earn you respect in your community and earns you respect with your customers. You have to know what your customers love and what your brand stands for.
Right. Everyone should be able to answer, why do your customers shop with you? Anyone here the cheapest place in town? Right? Anyone here give the best customer service in town? Does anyone know if giving that best customer service is what makes your customers come to you? Right? So we all have to find out why do people shop at our store?
Yeah, and what our reputation and getting that together.
Right.
Now, here's the thing. You're not going to go out of business just this season or next week. You have to be in business all 52 weeks. All year round, you have to be communicating to your customer what your brand is about. In other words, even if you're running a promotional strategy, you have to consider that you want to be in business this week and the next week and the week after that.
Right. So that means this is hard for us to do. You need to have, BJ, I'll go into this, you need to have a calendar, a thought ahead calendar of promotions and things that will get people in the store. How many of you are like me and you do things last minute that someone comes in and says, oh, this is a great idea, we're gonna do this. And am I the only one? Right? We all, and that is the kiss of death. It blows budgets. I don't even know how many of you actually sit down and do a budget, but it is impossible to do a budget. It's impossible to run a business like that. And that's one of the advantages that the big guys have over us. Isn't it amazing that your reps will walk into your store and they won't know, or you get from the distributors, you get March's deals, March 1st, but Petco and PetSmart has already had those flyers out, right, on March 1st, which means they got them 2 months earlier than we got them, right?
Yeah, and And I think one of the hints here, we didn't just put the picture up for beauty, is the way that you do that, because you go, oh my God, this is so overwhelming. How am I going to get through 52 weeks of marketing ideas? Well, you divide it into four seasons. Consumers think in seasons, and each season brings its own holidays, and each holiday brings its own buyers. So if you start looking, and if you really study what the NRF puts out for independent retailers each year, it says, watch your holidays. Those are the days that people really go out to shop. So if you wait to spring to start telling people you have a spring deal, too late, right? You want to be prepared ahead of time, and since you know that the seasons won't change, at least weather climate is, you know, it may be colder for longer or hotter for longer, but we still have some semblance of the seasons. Seasons still help us coordinate our lives. And if you look at it from a mythological perspective, since we have a little more time today, I wanted to get a little more in depth with you guys. Each season has a mythology, an idea behind it. And if you tap into that story as a local community, you're tapping into the customer's heart right away.
So let me ask you a question. For folks like us, would you say that four major events a year is perfect?
Four major events is easy to plan.
Right.
It fits into your seasons.
Right.
And you are now having a 52-week branding program, something that's consistently in the mind and hearts of the customer. I mean, we're talking about an idea that you don't want to wait to the last minute to get customers in and promote and promote and promote, because that's where you lose your margins and you lose the opportunity for growth, really.
Right. Okay.
So let's go something through the foundations, like we said. So this is like the high-level overview. You need to have a brand. You need to have a strong 52-week message. But let's go into the foundation of how you do this. Before you start, you need to have a balanced foundation of how to create your business. So first things first, you can't be everything to everyone. Dave, anything to add here for that?
No, you know, everyone here of niche marketing? So every one of us, whether you're in a high-end store that you won't carry anything with byproducts or whatever, that is your niche. You're not going to sell bags of Pedigree. When I walk into a store, we don't sell Fancy Feast because this or that. If that is going to be your niche, if it's, I know Bob has a huge fish store. If fish is your niche, whatever your niche is, that's what you have to be. But here's the key, here's where we get into trouble, is we will try to market to people who aren't in our niche, and that's where we waste money.
Yeah, and that goes to that old adage that 50% of your money is being wasted, but you don't know which 50. But the reality is, like Dave says, when you do statistics, and you know, for example, working for the bigger retailers like a Kohl's or a Shields or a Target, you can easily see what money is being wasted, because you see when you market to the wrong niche, you lose your money. So, you know, take a freebie from the free guys. It's like, don't waste your money on marketing to folks who you can't convince. I like to divide the continuum into brand lovers, brand believers, brand nomads, and then brand haters, people who, you know, so it's like when you start putting your money down the left end of the continuum, it takes way more energy to convert these people. So only a small portion of the population is interested of what you have to offer. You waste time and money to trying to market to everyone. And think about also the power of a great story, or when you look at great advertising or good marketing, or you notice that it's really targeted at someone, that someone is the target. So just think of someone that you would market to, and then comes the question, well, how do you find the right market, right? Because if I was sitting there going, well, yes, I have to market to the right people, but how do I know which is the right selection for me? So choosing the right market, here are four tips. There's endless tips, but these are four that we feel are very powerful and can help you select that. Market size. Who are you targeting, and how many potential customers are in your marketplace? So again, drawing that radius, 5 miles around your store. How many people live in the vicinity within 5 miles of your store? If you're a .com, how many people visit .coms like yours? You know, all this information is readily available, right?
So let me, here's the practical part about this one. You can get from your credit card companies, and hopefully many of you are collecting your customers' contact information. So the easiest thing to do, for example, is what zip code do most of your companies for that particular store, if you're a multi-store, shop in? If 60% of them shop in 01001. Well, guess what? That's where your marketing should be, not to the other zip codes. Because it's easier to attract customers who are more likely to come to your store.
Yeah, so point number two, market wealth. Does the target market have money to spend on your products? And again, this is not as difficult to find as you may think. This is readily available information on the internet. It's like, well, if you know your target market, their life situation, then you can, in essence, create the right niche and the right consumer offers to them. But you have to know, for example, if you're going to bring something over their wallet, they'll never be able to afford it. Or if you're bringing something so cheap that you're undervaluing the market that you're in, because it could go both ways. You know, everyone thinks it's only one way, but I've seen retailers actually underestimate the market wealth and only market to one segment and miss out on completely an entire population of people that were sitting right in their backyard that had the money for this. The third aspect is look at market competition. Is the market saturated with competitors? Are you sitting in a hot spot where everyone's doing the same exact thing you want to do? Are you unique? And if you are in that, then you have to begin to differentiate back. How are you competing against that? The third way to choose your market is your brand story. Is your value proposition unique enough to cut through the noise? What is your differentiator? In other words, do you actually have something that's so unique that the entire market would pay attention to you? And if it is, make sure that you're making a big deal out of this. It's, as a matter of fact, you want to make a headline from this perspective.
Right.
So define your vision. Success is different for every retailer. For every person in life, as a matter of fact, may define success slightly different. So how do you define success? Define your idea or your vision early. In other words, to Dave's story, when Mindy came in 6.5 years ago into HSN, 7 years ago, she said, this is a vision and the people that are gonna be on board are gonna understand it. Also make sure that each of your team and partners understands your definition of success. If you look at some of the most successful retailers, whether they are large or small and happy, right?
Right.
Because there are small and happy retailers, they're because people who have defined their vision and they have an idea of what that vision looked like and also stay consistent each month. In other words, don't change your vision. 1 week is one idea, the next week you want to be something else. Spend a little time knowing your customer and defining your vision. These are things that should be long-term and they're going to guide you as you make decisions for your business over the long term. You have to set core metrics. In other words, even if you're not into numbers or insights or consumers, or you have to set some form of metrics, and these are not just accounting metrics, like I'm talking about customer metrics, and find things that you can attach meaning to. In other words, maybe you're a beginner at metrics, so you get a counter for your door so you can see how many folks walk in. But then, how do you connect that metric to something more humanistic? For example, how many customers walked out with something in their hands? So use any small tool that can give you an edge on metrics, but then connect some meaning to that metric that you are going to try to improve.
So let me give you a couple of examples of what kind of metrics. I know retailers that will put what sales per hour per employee. Very easy. Store does $5,000 on a Saturday. Here's the list of employees that you had working. How much per employee did they do versus next Saturday when you have, or Sunday when you have a different crew on and they do X amount plus? Well, if that is real low and that's, those same employees are working different times, you know that they're not performing that well, right? Everyone, I assume, knows their average transaction. Is your average transaction higher when Bob and Mary are working than it is with Joe and Phil? And this is not rocket science. We can all do this really easily, but these are the kind of metrics, you don't have to pay some company to come in and do this. This is the kind of stuff we all should be doing.
Yeah, and again, it gives you the ability to look at your customer acquisition funnel. In other words, what helps you acquire customers and then try to measure ways to do that. So one measurement that you can use that is very easy to do, and you can ask every single associate that walks through your door or every single person that's there, would you recommend us to your friend or family? One of the things that they've done a lot of studies about this question and research, but the reason it's so powerful is because we humans are biologically driven to want to belong and want to share information and not to look bad in front of our friends and family. And because of this, this question gets to the heart and essence of what the service experience is really about. Did we create such an experience that helps people come back, or are we pushing them away? So simple question, a one question assessment of your customer can give you incredible insights. People that give you a high score for recommendation are 99% likely to be the people who spend the most money with you. And those are the same folks that you want to bring in for lunch one day and go, hey, what do you really like about our store, and what could we do to make it even better? So instead of just asking, and this is one of the things that drives me nuts about folks that do research, is that they'll just ask anyone anything about anything, right? So it's like if I wanted to know a lot about Dave, I could go and ask 50 strangers, which would tell me very little, or I could ask his best friend. If I asked his best friend, I would have a better idea who Dave is. So if you want to ask someone about your business, don't go around asking your haters. And a lot of business owners, believe it or not, will do this because they ultimately, maybe insecurity and things like that, say, well, what are we doing wrong? What are we doing wrong? What I'm saying is, this will help you find what you're doing wrong, but what I really want you to focus is what is you doing right and how can you keep doing that even better, because that will inherently improve your weaknesses.
Right, so here's a practical way to do this. You have a little form that says, would you recommend us, let me ask you quick, because I do this, would you recommend us to your friend or family and why?
And why is the follow-up?
So here's what you can do. You can print this up and say, I'm gonna reward you. Please fill this out, bring it up, bring it back. Next time you come into the store, here's a $5 coupon for your effort. You think it's worth $5? These are your best customers anyway, and you set the parameter. You don't give it out to everybody. You give it out to everybody who spends over $50, which is anybody who buys, the way prices are going, a 6-pound bag of dog food, right? But anyone who spends over X amount of money in your store in that transaction, you give them that and say, send it back. We're bribing you.
Getting to that marketing. So now you know who your customers are, you know where you perform well. Well, how do you set this budget? So here's some tips from the pro. Start with 8%. Right? Don't kill me yet, Dave. Dave and I went back and forth. So here's what Dave and I have figured out, right? And this is sort of our current compromise, right? It's like if you are just starting your business, right?
Yeah.
And you have no customers walking through your door, you are going to have to spend about 8% of your revenue to get folks in. But Dave has figured out that you can.
I spend about 2%. And that 2% includes all my rewards and all my discounts and all my promotions.
Right.
And during this seminar, we'll explain to you how
but
I spend.
But now, let me give you the warning, right? Before everybody goes around right. Trying to be Dave.
Right.
Dave is a really clever marketer. And his marketing is really sticky, and people laugh a lot and enjoy it and like it, and they like his store. So when you have that going for you, you have this multiplying factor. So keep in mind that what we all want to work for is an effective store that's so popular that you don't even need advertising,
correct.
Right? So 2% is great, 1% would be even better, but going out of business because you're not spending money on advertising, that's not acceptable. So that's the idea. You start at a level that you're attracting the customer is, and then look at it backwards. So where are your costs going to go into? Brand development costs. What do I mean by that? Your image, your look, your feel, your decorations, how your store looks and feel, and the cost of promoting your retail business. In other words, now that you have a great story, you have to go tell someone. It doesn't do you no good sitting in your home or under your pillow. So spend your budget wisely. This means having a media plan that is consistently remembered, and you want that 52-week concept. You don't want to just market once. You want your marketing program to fit into a larger puzzle that allows you to continue to market over and over.
Everything you should do should be personalized. Think about this for a minute. There's no such thing as Fred Petco, right? How do customers build trust with the owner of the business? Every single thing you do should be personalized. And if you're not, if you're camera shy, you don't want to be, get someone in your organization who exudes the passionate, and we all have somebody who works for us like that, to be in every single thing we do.
Yep. And again, it's just very simple, especially as an owner, to take that ownership of that. It's very important.
Yep.
And a lot of people miss that opportunity. I mean, it's such a great one for business owners. So the next idea is get involved in the community, right?
So I'm sure that, how many of you get involved with rescues and shelters and all that kind of stuff? So let me give you some other ways to get involved in the community. While those things are wonderful, places like Kiwanis clubs, Rotary clubs, any kind of service organizations, they love to, they have speakers come in at every one of their meetings. They love nothing more than listening to small business people on how they compete with the big guys. And they love it because everybody owns an animal, right? So they all love you. You should be in front of every single organization that you can possibly do. Number one, it's free. Number two, your passion is contagious. And that's a great way to get new customers for free. So this is great because I stole this from Russ Herrmann, who I write about in my articles all the time. So we'll pay to help spay and neuter, and everybody please steal this. We will pay to help spay or neuter your dog or cat. Does that make us look like the hero or not? Right? Think about it. And we give you 12 $5 gift cards to our store every month. Duh. Right? So what happens? The shelters love us. The rescues love us. The customers love us. It's an absolute win-win-win. I spend, I don't know, almost all my time trying to figure out how to get people to love me, because I know if they love me, all things being equal, they'll shop at my store instead of the competitor stores. So the customer, if you spay or neuter your dog, you bring your personal pet. You bring in the receipt that says I spayed or neutered my dog, I will give you 12 $5 gift cards. If you adopt a pet from any adoption agency, you bring the paperwork in, I'll do the same thing.
Yeah, and now think about how brilliant, right? You just adopted a pet,
right?
And instead of being alone in the world and no one cares that you have a pet, Dave's says, hey, come in and we'll help you get started.
Right.
It's like a friend for life. You have a customer for life.
And of course, we try and work with every, how many of you do this? You have a goodie bag with every shelter so that when the customer adopts that pet, they come to your store. Bingo, I just paid for your trip, right?
So ask your customers what they care about, you know? That's an easy way to get involved in the community. What do you care about?
We've done SurveyMonkey a lot. Do you like that?
Survey
so
Monkey,
everyone know what SurveyMonkey is? Right? It's a great way to ask customers about their opinions about what's going on in your store. I also recommend, correct me if I'm wrong, you got to reward them for filling out the survey.
Sure. Yeah.
Yep.
Especially if they're not part of your database,
right,
or if you don't have any connection. But you can ask them, right? And they're available and they'll tell you.
Yep.
And that'll give you great ideas on what to do next. I mean, in the power of cold branding, we looked at Harley Davidson and Oprah Winfrey as brands, as powerful brands. And one of the things that Harley does over and over for the last 100 years is ask their customers, what else do you want to do? What else do you guys care about? And you build incredible power with that. So,
right. So this is another example of getting involved in the community. So that every town has this now. It's the Bark for Life. Anyone doing this in their towns? So we're a sponsor. But the big deal is, once again, we get people to love us, and they do the marketing for us. That's the other part with the shelters. This is how I have such a stingy budget. They market my store for me. I don't have to spend any money. It's a beautiful thing.
Yeah, and that community marketing is really where I spent the last 12 years thinking about cult branding and belonging, and there's just nothing more powerful than to build a brand. I mean, Kohl's, all the retailers I've worked for, anytime that we've installed anything related to community building, I mean, Shields, you know, just boom, it's just so huge.
Right.
Because they're already a community and you're just participating. So, of course, you have to Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, and Pinterest, right? Think of, I'm gonna just break it down like this. You know, Pinterest is one of the new things, but think of Pinterest as inspiration medium. People go there to get ideas. Think of YouTube as like seeing is believing. Twitter is the talk of the town, and Facebook is the gossip, right? It's like, so you have this continuum of ways that consumers talking, communicating, sharing photos. We're still like a little bit in the Roman times. People either thumbs up or thumbs down. There's no, well, it was nice, you know, so you're living in a very hostile environment on YouTube and Facebook and Pinterest. So I could see how a lot of folks shy away. But the only thing you need to shy away from these mediums is buying into too heavily and spending your money the wrong way in them.
All right, explain
They are
that.
Great mediums. Well, so here's the deal, right? Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, and Pinterest, all these brands, all these social medias come from the environment of wanting to get, let's say you advertise with them, they want to get your money, they want to get those clicks. So the algorithms that they've built will try to get clicks because that's how they make money. So you have to be very careful when you buy advertising into any of these, because if you set the parameters wrong, your clicks will go like this and you will have no results to show for it. In other words, even if, let's say, you try to do Facebook advertising, and let's say you do a 5-mile radius around your store, it's like, this is all I want. Facebook may say to you, well, we won't be able to spend your budget. Guess what? Good. Don't change a thing, right?
So explain. Is anyone spend money on Facebook? How many of you? All right, so explain that, because a lot of people don't, so how they can do that.
Yeah, in other words, you know, you want to make sure that your segmentation is clear. Going back to that, who is your customer, where are they coming from? Because Facebook will try to get your ads clicked on faster than not, disregarding whether you get any results or not. So it's not that I'm against Facebook or for Facebook, I'm just saying caution, because it's digital and it's being pumped to people that even click a lot. So, you know, again, if I had the statistics, I should go, hey, Jim likes to click a lot, even though he never buys anything, but he's a great guy for me. So I keep sending Jim the ad because he clicks, but Jim never buys, right? So you have to be careful with that. In other words, measure these things carefully, but try to participate without paying as much as you can.
So I got into trouble for this at the in Las Vegas last year. I caused an uproar at that PIES conference that everyone got. So I said, in your Facebook postings, how many of you post, your company has a Facebook page, and you post on it, right? I said, you should not put ads in those posts. And I got people screaming at me, you're an idiot, you don't know what you're talking about. So where I got that from is, it's my thing, and BJ will correct me if I'm wrong, when you're on Facebook, it's like you're home for dinner, and you want to know what's going on with all your relatives. You haven't seen them all year, right? Your uncles and aunts, everyone's over, right? You want to know what's going on. It's a social thing. And then your uncle leans over you and says, how'd you like to buy some life insurance? right? So to me, that's like the intrusion of Facebook putting an ad in your post. That's not what people want to see.
Yeah.
The Facebook, so am I right or wrong?
Right, and then you want to use
now,
it to socialize.
But,
be social.
Right. But if you want to buy an ad on, I don't know, German Shepherd Nation,
right,
or Blue Buffalo's page.
Perfect.
On one of those sides that you can do within 5 miles of your store that says we have the best prices on Blue Buffalo, that's fabulous.
Yeah.
Right?
We hope that helps you build trust with your customer. And that is the most important key to having customers that will come back and do business with you. Remember that earning that trust happens through every touch point, through every advertising, and through all your marketing. And of course, Dave wrote customers love, and I wrote customers first. So hopefully, if you guys have more questions or insights, some of these books can help you answer how to better understand your customers. Thanks for
right.
the time.
Right, and I'm just, my final word is, out of all the advertising and marketing that we do, gaining the trust of the customer, because think about this, our customers trust us with the health of the creatures that they love more than anything in the world. It is an incredible honor not to be screwed with, right? So our job is to make sure to gain and maintain that trust. And it's not just you, it's every one of your employees, and then the reason that I spend so little on marketing is my customers do it for me. So again, BJ and I will be at the booth for a little bit to answer any of your questions. Thank you very much, you guys.
Thanks.